We're off to Cape York for an adventure. Why don't you come along for the ride?
On our way from Brisbane to Weipa. Oh, and these planes aren't the actual planes we flew on. They're just toys to represent our flight, just in case someone was worried. Anyway, so we made it to Weipa Airport and were picked up by Colin and Kat Hempsall, my parents, and we're on the way for the start of our adventure. First stop is the Weipa Shopping Centre. We're going to be an hour and a half away from Weipa at the Pennefather Camping Grounds, so it's best to stock up on as much food as you can while you're in town, because it's a long journey back there. And here we go, we're on the way to Pennefather.
Down here because we've got to go up the sand dunes in about 100 metres.
So what pressure do they need to be?
We only got them at 30, but most blokes got them down at 20.
Start of the sand dunes. So we've let the tyre pressure down to 30, but most people let it down to 20 so that we can get over the sand dunes a bit easier. Welcome to Pennefather Campgrounds. Turtles nesting between June and September. Ranger's office over here, but it's pretty much abandoned at the moment. But there is water and electricity there and a telephone and a freezer, so
You can put things in the freezer if you need to.
There's a lagoon in front of the camping grounds. We've seen about five or six crocodiles in there. They're not too big, but they just normally come up and sun themselves on the other side. One larger one just cruises up and down. Most people here come back every year because they love it so much. So we're off now, up on the quad bikes, to catch some bait. Well, it looks like Cole drew the short straw because he's the one who's got to go out in the deep water to drag the net around to catch the bait. No luck this time, just these little black and white fish that you can't use for bait.
There's a big one there.
So we'll have to do it again. Take two. Got some good sized mullet this time, so we're ready. Got our bait, we can go fishing.
Got a good bait.
So we've loaded the boat in using the quad bike, and then we're going out up the river to see if we can catch some fish for dinner. And then on the way back, we're going to go and visit a croc hunter's camp. Back in the early 1950s, 60s, croc hunting was legal.
Mum, you have to hold on.
And we got one, it's on, it's on. First fish of the day.
I'll reel this rod in.
Mine, yep. Can you eat those?
It's pretty good, very pretty.
Yeah, old Roy used it, but I'll let him go.
What's all those spots on him? Is that just what he looks like?
Yeah, spot in the valley there.
It's pretty good size.
So we're going in to have a look at the Crocodile Hunters camp, or what remains of it anyway, behind these mangroves. They would catch and skin the crocodiles when it was legal in the 50s and 60s, and then take them down to Cairns, the city, and sell the skins down there before returning here. Pretty lonely life though.
What's that?
Good shout, isn't it?
Bloody cut yourself off. There's a couple of drums there. What's that drum? It's got hooks on it.
that place is.
So when was he here? When was he last here?
Probably they stopped shooting about 1970, but I don't know whether it'd be 80, probably would have been earlier than that, you know, they'd have shot them all out here. But 1950s and 60s, just giving a commentary, this is the old fireplace. And
the old fireplace.
And that's the old shack. There's a creek in there, just up here.
So he just catch the crocodiles and then...
He shoots them, you know. You drive around at night with a light, and they see their eyes, the crocodiles don't take much notice of them at night. And he used to shoot them, and then he'd drag them in here and skin them. Then when he get enough skins, he'd probably have a slow old boat, head back up to where he found a road, and then sell his skins and get some rum and tucker and come back again. I'll just have a look here if there's any.
Back, thankfully, we thought we were going to be stuck in that mud all day. That's a prime spot for the crocodile to take you if he wanted to. So now it's time we're going to cook up some fish with our homemade batter.
Beer batter, we're going to have it with, put some fish into beer batter and fry it up later on. Fried fish in beer batter. Salmon and carrot.
So what have you got in there first?
We've got batter mixture, and then now we're putting beer in. Gonna use all the beer immediately.
And then you put your fish in there,
put
coat
the fish in now, and we'll leave it here for half an hour. Then we'll cook it up later on.
Okay, we'll come back for that. Cooked our chips on the fire.
Anyway, a couple in here, I don't want many. I'll have more fish than chips.
Put the fish in the battered fish.
Dropping it into the hot oil.
We have one of those things.
Peeps.
Fish and chips for dinner. Now this is why you don't go swimming at dawn or dusk, because just on sunset here, the sharks come out and feed. It's like a feeding frenzy all up and down the coast here. Sun goes down over the water in Queensland. Not something that you see all the time.
We're heading up to Flinders Camp to find where he camped in 1801. There used to be a marker up there, but we'll have to see if we can find it.
On a pretty isolated beach here off Cape York, but the amount of rubbish that is washed up here is amazing. Not sure if it comes off of ships out at sea or floats down from other countries, but for a beach with no footprints, there's a lot of rubbish. We're heading up to this oak tree up here in the distance. At one time there probably would have been a lot of oak trees growing, and this is where Matthew Flinders camped. So we're going to head up and see if we can see any of the remains of his camp.
In the early 1800s, Matthew Flinders circumnavigated Australia, and in 1802 he pulled in here to make repairs on his ship, the HMS Investigator. There's a post here marking the date that he arrived, but unfortunately it's disintegrated a little bit. It would be great if it could be fixed, because this is a fairly historical site.
Yeah,
boat, and we're off to see some wetlands that are just over one of the nearby sand dunes. A lot of magpie geese normally gather there, so let's go have a look. Now it's quad working time. We're going up along the side of the beach here. We're going to go into the bushes and see if we can find one of the hidden lagoons at Pennefather. All the hidden places in Cape York. We rode our quad bikes in and now we're just walking the rest of the way to find these lagoons. Just got to watch out for the wader wild vines. They've got big thorns on them and they hook into you and they'll keep you there for a while. Hence the name wader wild. More beautiful lagoons we've discovered, and they've always heard that the best place to look out for crocodiles is above.
Can you monkey to the top? can shake it to the west. You can shake it to the poodle dog. That dealer the best. Well, my dog can muck it just like you. But can you muck it to the
now the croc gets you.
The remains of another crocodile hunter's camp that we came across. This is a well he would have used up until the mid-1970s when it became illegal to hunt crocodiles in North Queensland.
The ants nest here. They live inside these leaves. They're all stuck together. And when you brush up against them, they all come running out and they'll bite you. If you can see that.
Down the beach to find two aeroplanes that were crash landed in the Second World War. They were down at Dyfton Point, they're a fair way down, so we better get going.
On it, so we're just going to write a little message and hang it onto the thong tree. What does your message say, Sky?
It says Sky Peter Colin Cathler here, 17th of July 2017.
Great, let's hang it on the tree. Queensland, there's one thing you always need to be on guard with when you're at the beach, and that's crocs. Even though the water looks really calm and beautiful and it's inviting and it's saying come in, come in, come in for a swim, always be on the lookout for crocs. I've just happened to find one now on the beach, so just be on guard. He's a big fella, so we'll just stand back and let him make his way naturally into the water.
Dyfton Point. It was during a search for new commercial opportunities in 1606 that a ship owned by the Dutch East India Company made the first recorded European contact with Australia. Captain William Janszoon sailed the Dyfton east of Indonesia to investigate rumours that New Guinea had large deposits of gold. So Janszoon and his crew were the first Europeans to walk on Australian soil. As we've been riding up the beach, we've seen a lot of turtle tracks, probably about 10 or so. They come out of the ocean and make their way up to the top of the sand dunes up here, and then dig a hole and lay their eggs in it. They're probably at the top there to get away from the high tide. And so then they'll lay their eggs, and I think the eggs stay in there for about 3 months, and until the babies hatch out, and the babies will come out and make their way to the ocean. We've seen here that it looks like something's been digging at the sand, but we couldn't find any cracked shells, so hopefully they're all still all right in there, and 3 months' time they'll make their way out and down to the beach and hopefully avoid all the birds and the fish and the sharks and the crocodiles that try to eat them on the way. We can only hope so anyway. Okay, we're throwing out our bottles into the ocean. Our message is in the bottle. Hopefully they'll get a bit further. Here are the remains of two P-47D Thunderbolts that crash-landed at Dyfken Point on about the 28th of October 1944. Apparently the two pilots became lost in the Torres Straits. The theory was that they were on their way to New Guinea and were told to keep the Queensland coast on their left-hand side. And they did this and did a sharp left-hand turn at the tip of Cape York. They kept going, keeping the Queensland coast on their left-hand side until they ran out of fuel. The two pilots were rescued, and then the US Army set off demolition charges on the two aircraft to make them safe in December 1944.
Rest stop midway from our journey. Another 25 kilometres to go before we get back to Pennefather. Not a bad spot for a rest. The ocean's so blue.
Along the beach, just in front of us, we saw a big rock laying here on the sand. Probably would have been about 16 foot or around 4 metres long. As soon as he saw us, the bird bites, he went into the water, but you can tell how big he is by his thigh marks. That's the width of his legs, so he's very big. Big daddy croc.
Okay guys, I heard you had a bit of a emergency today around camp.
We did. At about 9:45 this morning, a car came whizzing around the bend with a young couple and two babies in the car, saying that their friend had fallen out of the boat and the boat was spinning around. And they needed someone to go out to rescue him because they thought they didn't know where he was.
So how far away from camp was this, do you know?
Probably about a kilometre down the beach.
Okay, yeah.
How far is that roof, Dave?
Yeah, 5 k's.
5 k's.
Okay, yep.
So in the meantime, Kay and Simon...
Super Simon, you could
Super
call
Super Simon, went at Simo, went around to get the boat.
Yep.
And to go around and see if they could help rescue the gentleman in the water. And the boat was going around and around and around. And also, Dave hopped on his...
Super Dave!
On
Super
his,
Dave!
On my bike and rode down there.
And I heard you ran out of fuel or something.
Something died on it.
Not too hard, mate.
I could see the boat going around and Simon and some other bloke turned up and started searching around and I thought, well, he's gone.
So Simon was in the boat.
Simon
yep.
and his missus.
Yep, you were okay. Was in the boat. Yep.
Over to
bearing down this way, and another bloke come from the other side because he could see the boat going round and round. And they got there, and I saw a pull up out in the middle. I don't know what they're talking about. And then they went either way, so they went looking for him. It's glad we found him.
So you'd found the boat, but not the person?
Yeah, so we checked to see whether he was in the boat. We couldn't see him in the boat. And then we went out to sea a bit to look for him and came back in. And then his friend who came into the camp here got on the other guy's boat. And they sort of had seen where he was swimming and they saw him. And it was probably about maybe 200 metres off the beach.
Yep. Got him in the boat,
and,
yep.
And someone came along with a sat phone and called emergency services.
Okay, so they called emergency services, like, and then the helicopters came within
2 hours.
And where did they come from, the helicopters?
The helicopter came from Thursday Island.
Yeah. The trouble came along the coastline.
Yep.
We watched him come in.
So he's probably trying to find out exactly where they were. Yeah. And so he came in, and by that time, the bloke was ashore. Yep.
And the ambulance, we'd already put him in the ambulance. We commanded to put him in the ambulance.
Yep.
And they said the chopper's not far. We'll wait for the chopper because they didn't want to shake his guts out going over the dunes.
So they were going to try and take him in the chopper.
Yeah.
Yep. But
as far as we know, that's what they did.
So you don't know where the bloke was from?
But he was actually a local, he wasn't just working
there.
He wasn't flying fly out, was from there.
And they were camping up here?
No, they came out for a day trip.
Oh, just for the day, yep. And so his family were on the shore and they saw it first, didn't they? Yeah, and they came out.
27. And it was just good to see everyone pull together too, because by the time we got over there, as we saw the boat flashing in the distance, another guy came screaming up to this boat and said, someone, the boat's going around, there's no one in the boat. And he basically said, well, I'll go inland. And we sort of crisscrossed. By the time we got there, the people on the beach had spotted him. So he went and saw him, and they said, there he is, and they're picking him up. But he was pretty buggered. I reckon they were probably 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he'd been swimming for like half an hour at least.
Yeah, he's throwing up salt water.
Yeah. And
troubles breathing and everything.
Did he say what happened? Why he fell overboard?
He's dazed and confused. Yeah. He couldn't say much. He was out.
Yeah.
His mate said conscious, he slipped off the motor.
He was in shock.
Yeah. So yeah, because the boat was circling, you'd have to. It doesn't steer by the.
No.
No, it's got a big handle.
Yeah.
It's a big boat.
Yeah. So.
It only takes a quick flick of that, even to hit something in the water and you're out.
Yeah, you don't know until but as far as you know, he's okay.
Found amazing about the whole thing was how everyone pitched in, helped each other.
Yeah, it's good to see, hey.
Everyone who came along had an input into the situation.
Mm. Yeah, that's really good. He was lucky too that he had his family.
That's the law of the sea, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Never turn your back on a fellow boatsman. Or anyone in trouble out there, do you?
Kay and Simon did not hesitate.
This is how you get water when you're camping up here at Pennefather. There's a bore there and there's a pump and a pipe coming out. And to get it to come out, they follow the hose back over to the camping area. And then they get the power from the battery. They're hooking the battery, the cord onto the battery. So what does that do when you're hooking the battery on?
Well, it starts the pump in the bore.
So is there a button to turn the pump on, or it just starts up automatically? And so then the water comes out of the hose and you can use it to fill up the caravan, wash your clothes with, fill up your water bottles. The water bottles are out here, so how they heat their water is that they put the water in these big bottles and just leave it out in the sun, and then that heats from the sun all day, and then you can use it in your shower. And they've got a little pump that runs their shower as well. We'll have a look at that soon.
This is a bush shower. We connect it to a battery. We insert this device into a black bottle we leave out in the sun all day, and it gets hot, then we connect to a battery like so, then we grab this thing. Switch here. And you switch it on and away it goes.
You've got a shower.
Yeah,
you wash yourself
water.
With.
We're off on our quad bikes to find the remains of a B-17E Flying Fortress US aircraft that crashed here during World War II. The crew parachuted to safety, but some of the crew were still missing, so local Aboriginal trackers were taken to the crash site to find the remaining crew members.
Do you have them at home?
Yes. Only one, I think, up there.
One of the four motors from the US Army plane that crashed here in World War II. The rest are scattered about over a kilometre. So the crew parachuted out before the plane crashed. It's a fairly treed area, so I'm assuming there was this many trees back then as well. So luckily they parachuted out when they did.
We're taking the quad bikes in for a bit of a wash to get all the salt water off from underneath them to stop them rusting. And then it's back to camp to make some bush damper. Yum. Okay, we're gonna make some bush damper.
First, accurate measurement of flour in a saucepan. Like that. Teaspoons of sugar. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six, seven. Now I've got to get salt. We haven't got any salt on the table. So half a teaspoon of salt.
Self-raising flour.
Half a teaspoon of salt. And a spoonful of butter. Dessert spoon, you should have to say that's a big teaspoon. I think that's all we need. Now somebody's got a mix it. Kathy, come and mix it. Mix it. Job.
How much milk did you put in? You don't know.
Until it's finished.
About 2 cups.
Like
yeah, that way, and the other way.
waterfall.
Get some hot towels on the shovel. And we get the camp oven over here.
So you've just put wire in there to keep...
Yeah, just to keep it off the bottom.
Putting the damper in the camp oven.
Put the damper in. Put the lid on. Top. That one's too hot.
Looking good.
Yeah, it's cooked.
Comes out clean, it's cooked.
Right, oh, we're going to cut the damper.
Look at that.
Look at that. Beautiful.
Now, what goes with damper? A good cup of Billy tea.
10 or 12, we lived on a dairy farm, and on the farm there was a lot of timber. We used to milk the cows in the morning, and then I'd go cutting timber with my old man, help him pull it. We had a crosscut saw. We never used chainsaws those days, a long time ago, 60 years ago. And my job at Smoko and lunchtime was boiling the billy. He used to tell me to put a stick across the top of the billy like so down there to the fire. He reckons that stopped the tea from being smoked. And then after we put the tea leaves in, I just let it boil about two or three boil up times. Then we'd take it off and then get a stick. Just get some sort of a board or anything, and you had to hit the side of the billy like that to make the tea leaves go down. If you didn't do that, you got into serious trouble. That's about all I know about boiling billies. That's if you do that, you got it right. Now the billy's nearly boiled. I think you put a handful of tea leaves in. Like so, and you just wait till it turns over, boils a bit slow, not quite hot enough.
So it's got to boil up three times?
Yeah, three times. Well, the stick's fell in.
That's what I said. We need to pull your stick
the
out.
The stick has fell in. That's finished with the stick now. Now we've got to take it off before it boils over. And when you get it there, piece of wood. See how the tea leaves disappeared? That's marvellous.
It's good tea now.
Cool. Now do you have to spin it round?
Yeah, now you've got to get a hold of that. And give it a few nice spin.
Don't do that, but the old man never told me to do that. He thought I was too stupid. It'd cost me money to get me fixed up if it's called him.
It's time to go fishing.
Hello, little mackerel. He's a jumping fish.
It's almost time for us to start making our way back home. It's going to be a big drive, but a great one. So we're loading up the boat, getting ready to go.
Yeah, same here.
Right. And then we'll just square it up.
Need to lift it up more, they'll get, that'll be the widest point, we'll get narrower. Drop it down and lift it up more.
Yeah.
Ready? Push.
Yeah,
is that on the roof cull of your car, or what's that hitting on?
Push it along if you can reach it. Right along there, I'd hold it down.
How far, Cole?
Right up to these. Keep it going, further yet. Let's see that hole there on the side. It's bolt. I put a bolt through there.
Yeah, he bolts it on.
I'll be there, check the case.
Got to come back.
In goes the quad bike.
There's a lot of water in there at the moment, like it's been high.
One of the best things about camping is not just the places you go, but the people you meet. Here's Bob, the bush poet.
Eventually crumbling into getting up on the stage. There's 200 or 300 people there. And the mayor of Wangaratta and all these people anyway. Never been on stage in my life. Petrified I was. So I got up there and read a poem and they loved it.
Yeah.
They wouldn't let me off the stage. So I had to go out and knock a couple of cans back on the stage again. Yeah, so, and people wanted copies, which I gave away.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's the one time I did do it.
Yeah, you should keep doing it.
Yeah.
No, yeah, my daughters.
It's good how you can sort of make up things, you know, like it's like a love story, isn't it? A lot of them like are in those love stories you read.
Oh, a lot of stuff that I've written. It's actually stuff I've written too.
Love stories.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're actual copies of letters.
Yeah.
And they just became poetry, turned them into poetry. And some of them, I read them and people cry.
Yeah.
But what the hell? I can write funny stuff too. But I must start again. Because on the windy days when you're sitting there and you can't go fishing.
They're writing something down, yeah.
Yeah. That's good to be able to do that.
The only one I remember. That's
good. That
remember that one.
bit, I think you said it last year.
Yeah, exactly. A bit crude. You don't mind a bit of swearing on it? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Right. The dogs chewed up the oil drums and killed the kangaroo. He ate the cat and shat inside and scratched me juco too. Oh yeah, I just remembered he ate the bathroom towel. Another $100 to spend for cleaning out his bowel. I suppose he's bored and hungry. What else was he to do? But I abused him anyway, and the bastard's now shot through. But if he should wander home one day, and inside decide to bog, there's a bullet with his name on it. Who needs a fucking dog?
So we're off, heading south, on the road again. We're camping at Cowan tonight behind the Sex Change Hotel. Rumour has it that a group of drunken plumbers in 1976 put the S in front of the name Exchange Hotel, and now it's one of the most photographed places in the Cape.
A latte, please.
You meet the most interesting people at camping grounds. This couple here have got a coffee van and they're driving around Australia and they stop at camping grounds and offer coffee. Not a bad way to go.
Never mind.
There's an old coal mining grubber here. Must have been buried years ago in the mining days, and it's starting to come out of the ground now.
Now, we'd heard stories that a yowie had been seen in this area, so we thought we'd drive down the road to see if we could see any evidence. Looking into the story a little bit deeper, I read that a lot of the local Aboriginals believe that the yowies come from the dream time, and if they are to meet you, it's normally that they want to tell you something important. Skye draws a picture in the sand of a print that she'd seen while she was staying at a friend's place, believe it or not.
It wasn't a kangaroo either, it was big. It actually looked like that.
We're stopping for lunch at the Musgrave Telegraph Station. It was named after Sir Anthony Musgrave, who was Governor of Queensland from 1883 to 1888. The station was one of six constructed to service a new electric telegraph line on Cape York Peninsula in 1886. In the late 1920s, the high cost of maintenance and the low traffic on the line prompted the Postmaster General to consider closing some of the stations. Musgrave Telegraph Station was closed on June 22, 1929. Fred Shepherd bought the homestead in 1931. He died in 1952 and the properties continued to be operated by his wife Mary and family. Mary retired to Mariba in 1976 and the estate was divided between the families. Because of its location, Musgrave has always been of vital importance to the welfare of travellers in Cape York Peninsula. As most tourists began to visit the region, the family decided to turn the homestead into a roadhouse. Meals and drinks were originally served from under the house until the present cafe and accommodation were built in the 1980s. It's seen many changes, but is still owned and operated by family members.
She is loud, right?
Can't get under there, either.
What do you mean?
Mechanical problems are a big part of driving up the Cape, particularly because the roads aren't that great. But luckily for us, this is just a flat tyre. It won't be long, we'll be back on the road again.
Be going down, you know, I'll have to get dirty, but...
Oh, well. Can you see what it is?
Give us that lever thing.
Those birds, they're having a field day.
Town is at the mouth of the Endeavour River. It's where James Cook beached his ship the Endeavour for repairs in 1770. Both the town and Mount Cook, which rises behind the town, were named after James Cook. The actual town was founded on the 25th of October 1873 as a supply port for the goldfields along Palmer River. It was called Cook's Town until the 1st of June 1874. Cook's lookout on Mount Cook. James Cook came up here to try and see if he could find a way to take his ship out through the reefs. The British crew spent 7 weeks on the site of the present-day Cooktown repairing their ship, replenishing food and water supplies, and caring for their sick before they fixed the ship and sailed away. Black Mountains near Cooktown. Legends have it that herds of cattle, horses, and even people have ventured into these mountains, never to be seen again.
Thank you.
historic Lion's Den Hotel. It was established in 1875 and it's still going strong today. Now, the origin of its name supposedly came from a stowaway called Daniel, who was looking for work, and he left his adopted ship at Cooktown and was put to work in the mine. The tunnel is in the mountain opposite the present hotel building. The mine had no name when Daniel came to work there, and as the work was underground, it was a strange experience for Daniel. Upon seeing Daniel standing in the opening of the tunnel, the owner of the mine characterised him as Daniel and the Lion's Den, and the name took to the mine. The black tin slug, still in the hotel, came from the original Lion's Den mine. You'd be hard-pressed finding a spot inside the hotel where there's something that wasn't hanging. For a small donation, you can write your name on the wall, along with all the thousands of other people that donated.
Years ago there was 10 miners around here, and somewhere in these hills there was a town with 400 or 500 people. We were going to walk to it last year, but some of the walkers didn't turn up, so we never got around to doing it. There's an old army tank rolled down a gully there, and what's left of the old town.
Back on the mouth of the Bloomfield River, this bloke's taking his chances on a jet ski.
Bloomfield River. You can put boats in here. They used to actually get the school kids from the other side of the river and take them over by boat from over here to this side of the river, because the school's just across the road. Anyway, there was a great big crocodile hanging around here, so they had to remove it because I was scared that maybe it would get some of the kids one time.
Back on the road, travelling south, we're going to go through the Bloomfield track, which travels up through the Daintree National Park. At first stop, we're going to stop at the Bloomfield Falls, a beautiful little spot, just out of Woodjill Woodjill.
Up to here?
Yeah.
We're visiting Paranella Park. Jose Paranella had a dream to build a castle, and that he did in the 1930s. A man with vision ahead of his time. Blue spars of cardboard. Now, we heard from the shopkeeper that there's a lot of secret blue spars along the road that the public don't know about, but this is one of the ones that they do have sign marked. Now, the spars get their colour from the minerals in the ground, so it's safe to swim in there. It will be a great spot to relax in after a hot summer's day. And off we go.
I only give them about three quarts of a loaf. I meant to get another loaf out. I've got a fridge full of old bread there.
Just talk as you're doing it.
Hey?
Just talk as you're doing it. Just tell her what you're doing.
You could get the bread from, do you get like that old bread, you know, from the bakers where it's a day old and they sell it for cheap?
No, I've got a fridge full of it here, but it's frozen trouble. I guess it was some of ours. I've got a new loaf before, so we'll use this. They generally come up, it might be because you hear the generally come up hanging off the wet doors here.
They're in that tree there.
They're ready and waiting.
They're just hanging there in the tree. Isn't that pretty? Look at them in that tree.
Looks like little lights, Christmas lights.
Cole, come have a look. In the tree.
No, just doing gym. Just doing gym with the bread.
Oh, they're cute.
Heaps of them, isn't it?
But no dogs now.
Oh, no dogs. Yeah, one. Oh, he was.
Oh yeah. Where is she here? Is she here? Will she let us pat her?
Yeah, he's got no teeth.
This is some lucky birds.
They've got a gourmet tree here.
I don't give them quite as much bread today because I forgot to pull that loaf.
Well, there's a lot there.
You only get about a bit more than this sliced stuff. This is the old stuff we went.
So you just mulch it up until it's all mulched up?
Yeah. It just disappears.
Yeah.
They all get in there and as fast as you throw it out, just about gone.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can't leave that door open.
They come inside?
Because everybody's here.
Yeah, they're a bit scared to come in.
They come, and then they get bamboozled through the house and knock things over. And along the limbs of the trees up there.
Went up the sky, they might land.
I think somebody might catch them and they get something different. One day, Josh and Nicky were here, and I freed them away, freed them outside. Well, Josh was getting up and shouldn't have pulled it. I get real cranky.
There's heaps of them, isn't there? Whoa!
The fairy's deep and then you go up again, you know.
Yes, is that still on this road? Or?
I might be going through it.
Yeah, it's here.
We made it to Pothole. We're here to visit some more rallies. Ryan and Melda and Kay and Ray. At the end of March 2017, Cyclone Debbie came through here and she stripped most of the leaves off the trees and the mangroves, but they're all just starting to grow back now. We're camping here at Pothole. A lot of the original shed is now in the creek here.
Ray's taken us for a cruise up the river to check it out.
Fishing one day and they pulled up the top of the filter and they lit it up in there too.
There'll be a nice reef here one day.
Move over that way a little bit, Mum.
Is there a lot of crabs in here?
Yeah.
What, Mum?
Has been. We haven't gone. We did have to be.
Looks good.
Take a photo of that.
Pretty good.
What do you call this, Ray?
Okay. Curried sausages.
Curried sausages. You got special mix, but.
Oh yeah. Bloody hell. Highly bloody protected recipe. You know where I'm going.
Okay, we're coming to the end of our trip, and we're here at Pothole, and we've seen a lot of places, and we've met a lot of people. And is anything anyone wanted to say before our trip ends?
Hear, hear!
Go Cowboys!
Kath, anything you wanted to say?
No. Well, Peter, I've got Melda, lots to say.
Come and tell us something, Melda.
Probably haven't got a lot of time to say. Get your dad first. Okay.
It's been a good trip, and we've seen a lot of things and done a lot of things, and please buy the movie for $100 when it comes out.
Make a dollar.
Just see what it is.
I hope it's a movie. I hope it's a
movie. Libio up there.
Libio's
telling us what the weather's
going to
be.
Hey, Libio.
What he wants to say. Come on, Libio. Oh, you've
got Brian, have you got something to say? Enlighten us?
Yeah.
I'm relieved.
And Melda, we need the same voice here, Melda.
Okay, Peter. Well, I'm just so happy you have come to visit us on your quick trip, very quick trip. And I'd love to see this movie when it's all over, but I don't know if I've got... Oh, I could say Go Cowboys, North Queensland, but...
Look at the big thumb. And Jonathan's out and, of it.
Oh, yeah, Jonathan's out of it.
They get that in without it. They prove that.
Bit sad.
Oh, no, not quite.
Kay, do you have anything else to say about Jonathan? No, we all love Jonathan.
I just love we're going to finish the night with.
Well, Ray's going to show us something to finish the night with.
I left the lid off.
Oh, yeah, lovely dinner.
Stew.
What about the stew?
Look at that, guys. Looking good.
Good.
And so with that, we'll say it's a wrap until tomorrow anyway.
My true love was true.
Let's
see what Ray's going to do. Ray's going to fix it.
They said someday you'll find all who love are blind. Oh, when love's on fire, you must stay alive. Smoke gets in your eyes.
Now we've got it.